Premature ovarian insufficiency is a reproductive disorder that affects approximately 1% of the reproductive aged population. And its effects are quite profound and widespread, and they have systemic impact on the well-being and quality of life of those that are affected by it. So yes, it has an issue where patients that are trying to conceive, if they have premature ovarian insufficiency, the likelihood of them conceiving significantly decreases. But we also see that there are other issues that premature ovarian insufficiency is associated with. For example, a increased risk of cardiovascular disease, and increased risk of musculoskeletal disorders. There's a higher risk of having dyslipidemia, so an imbalance in the cholesterol levels. It can also affect things like genitourinary symptoms, like vaginal dryness, and pain during intercourse, dyspareunia. And it seems to also affect things like sleep disorders and mood because of the decreasing estrogen levels. And estrogen actually has a very big impact on the production of certain neurotransmitters in the central nervous system. So now there's more and more research coming out on how diet and certain nutrients may have an impact and in the role of either accelerating the progression of something like POI, premature ovarian insufficiency, or potentially delaying and slowing it down there as well for some patients. So based on these studies, a lot of them are still observational, so they have their limitations. They can only establish something that's known as correlation, but don't establish causation. Nonetheless, I think it's still important to have an understanding of what are the lifestyle factors, nutrients that seem to be positively correlated with better outcomes for patients that are struggling with POI. So out of the macronutrients, number one, we see that a higher intake of certain carbohydrates, particularly galactose, has been associated with a quicker time or quicker progression of POI, and it seems to be damaging to the ovary and may have a negative impact on those that are stuck with or suffering with POI. Oppositely, patients who have a higher protein intake, now there's various observational studies that have now found higher protein intake may actually delay the onset and progression of something like menopause. It seems to have a protective effect on ovarian aging and reproductive function there as well. So whether that's through modulating oxidative stress or antioxidant function, it's not very clear, but we see, for example, in one particular study, having fish about 3 times a week and eating eggs at least 4 times a week was associated with a delayed onset of menopause, and other studies finding that higher protein intake, finding very similar findings, higher protein intake was associated with delaying the onset of menses and potentially delaying progression there as well. So those are the macronutrient studies that we've seen. When we talk about micronutrients, like certain vitamins, there are some animal studies looking at B vitamins, but when we look at animal studies, we interpret the results with a huge grain of salt because they haven't been applied to human studies, of course, so there's a very big difference if we can start making recommendations like that. So I'm going to skip over some of the vitamins that are just limited to animal studies, and we're going to focus on products and nutrients that have actual human trials there as well. So for example, vitamin E, tocopherols, is an antioxidant, and it's been suggested that higher intake of vitamin E, for example, in one study they gave patients vitamin E for about 3 months that had POI, and they found that after the 3 months, they saw an increase in the volume of the ovaries, which is very significant because with POI and ovarian aging, one of the things we start to see is that the ovaries will actually shrink. They'll actually decrease their volume. So the increase in volume, and then they're also seeing increase in levels of a particular hormone called anti-Müllerian hormone, or AMH. And AMH, this hormone, is a very accurate predictor of egg reserve or ovarian reserve. So we're seeing that the AMH levels are going up, and we're seeing that the ovarian volume is also increased in patients that were given vitamin E for at least 3 months. Then we have a group of nutrients called phytoestrogens. Phytoestrogens, especially dietary phytoestrogens, are basically these compounds that have mild estrogenic activity. They can bind to some of the estrogen receptors in the body. So if someone who's very deficient in estrogen, the consumption of phytoestrogens may actually help increase the activity and stimulation of those estrogen receptors. So estrogens found from certain foods were actually associated with alleviating symptoms of menopause and genitourinary symptoms also that are common with menopause. And then we looked at, in these studies, the role of certain probiotics and prebiotics. And this is really important because your gut microbiome actually becomes a very important source of estrogen. There's an entire group of bacteria dedicated to metabolizing estrogen in the large intestine, and we call that the estrobolome. And the estrobolome can either increase our absorption of estrogen or it can decrease our absorption of estrogen. So your body works very hard to metabolize and excrete the estrogen from the body, from the liver to the bile to the intestines to the large intestine, and the large intestine can basically reabsorb that estrogen. So someone who has very low estrogen to start with, increasing estrogen recycling and the efficiency of that recycling may actually help to increase estrogen levels as well. So this is where we see certain studies on how giving probiotics and certain prebiotics may actually help to modulate the level of estrogen in the body, may help to alleviate some of the symptoms of menopause as well. And we see that combining prebiotics with those same phytoestrogens we talked about before. Prebiotics are basically fermented fibers in the digestive tract. They're used as food sources for the bacteria to help support the growth of healthy microbes. And so combining prebiotics with certain phytoestrogens together actually seems to enhance the availability, the bioavailability of these phytoestrogens, and may potentiate their beneficial impact for menopausal symptoms as well. And we see combining probiotics and prebiotics seems to have a beneficial effect there as well. And earlier I mentioned that one of the issues we see with menopause and POI is actually decreased bone health. So we see that there's increased risk of things like osteoporosis. And interestingly, a diet that is high in fibers and a diet that is high in prebiotics particularly, we see that it can have a very beneficial impact in the digestive tract to help us better absorb calcium. So the production of those certain acids that are produced as a result of fermentation of those fibers can lead to increased absorption of calcium through the gut lumen. And in turn improving calcium levels in the blood, which can then also help with bone health there as well. So this actually brings up an important topic, which we've touched on our other videos, which we don't really have the scope to dive deep into this video, but nutrition is not necessarily just about what you are taking, but it's about what you are absorbing. So for example, if someone has a diet that's very high in calcium, how much of that are we actually absorbing and how much of that are we excreting through the bowel movement? So this is where modulating the gut microbiome through prebiotics, probiotics may actually potentiate the absorption of some of these important nutrients. And like always, all the information discussed in this video is for educational purposes. Before you start anything, change anything to your lifestyle, diet or medications, always speak to your healthcare provider to see what is safe for you, what is effective for you, and what is actually recommended for you.